this is Ed from Ed, Fred, and Ed, and you are listening to GuildCast.
GuildCast is a weekly podcast series based on the three pillars of the Graphic Artists Guild: advocacy, community, and business resources. Keep listening to learn more about the Graphic Artists Guild and visit our website at www.graphicartistsguild.org.
The way things are, you know, families schedule their, they schedule things within their family. Okay, we're going to do family time at this time. Mm-hmm. It's not a bad thing, but it puts us to be held accountable that we're going to make sure we spend time with our spouse or significant other, that we're going to make sure we spend time with our children, right. You know, that we make time for our families. You got to schedule that in. At least you're being intentional with your time. So it's not a bad thing to do that. It's better to do that and be an awareness of it than to just let everything fall to the wayside and you're not even focusing on your family because you're just so busy working.
GuildCast is brought to you in part by Graphic Arts Today. This week's community episode features life coach Nicole J. Carr as she connects with members on survival.
What's up, people? This is Camille. I am here with Miss Nicole J. Carr, and she is a life coach, a trainer, a mentor, and so many things. She's just overall a positive person, and we are welcoming her today as a host for our Member Connect, our Guild Member Benefit, our Member Connect that speaks to our personal growth. And she's going to be sharing some tips on survival. We're all creative professionals here, so she's going to tie everything in and make it applicable to our lives. So, ready, Nicole?
Well, thank you, Camille. It's such a pleasure and delight to be here. So I just want to extend a thank you for having me on this Zoom seminar here to talk about different topics. And today's topic is survival. So when we talk about survival, I'm sure a lot of things come to mind. You know, the main thing is when we think about survival, we think about our environment, what we're experiencing, you know, physically. But another important factor that we're here to mostly talk about is how we survive emotionally, mentally, you know, for overall well-being. So that's the focus that we're going to have today in terms of the topic of survival. So depending on your situation, you may be going through a survival situation physically, your environment-wise, or you may be going through survival mentally, trying to figure out how to survive in our day-to-day. And, you know, in our world that's so complex, ever-changing, fast-paced, you know, you're in a daze sometimes and wondering how to get through one day to the next. So it's really crucial that for our personal growth and development to be successful, that we practice certain things, that we have a certain type of mindset so that we can move forward in a positive way, so that we can grow and learn and be able to move on, right? Because we all go through challenges, but it's just how we deal with it. That's the biggest thing, right? So as creative professionals, I am one of myself, seeing you all here as creative professionals, we create what we want. We create what we desire, what we want the other people to see, what pleases us. But we also need to think about how we create our own lives within that as being a creative professional, because we steer our own life. We create our own life. So it starts up here in the mental and how we deal with things. That's really important. So what we have to acknowledge is that in order to survive, we have to create boundaries for ourselves. As creative professionals, you make a lot of decisions every day. I am a creative professional, but I work in a professional environment full-time as a school administrator as well. So I know what it's like to be in a very challenging environment, overseeing, managing, supervising, working with different groups of people, making quick decisions, evaluating. So all of those things definitely can take a toll in any type of job like that. And you have to know how to make it through day to day so that way you can start anew, because the next day you're going to go through the whole thing all over again. Right. So when we talk about setting boundaries for ourselves, some of the things we need to focus on is how do we meet those high demands, those tight deadlines, right? How do we deliver with these high expectations that we're given a lot of times to our clients and our expectations they have of us? And all the multitasking that we do day to day, sometimes we may not even realize we're doing it because we're just trying to keep up with the pace of daily life, right? Mm-hmm. And also just adapting to changes. You know, things are happening constantly, frequently, before you turn around. And it's like, how do we deal with that? And a lot of that has to do, again, with the socio-emotional. How do we take that in? You know, what they say, life is 10% what happens to us and 90% how we react to it. And we really have to understand that, because if we don't have a good grip on how we deal with things, it could definitely take us over.
Right.
So I just want to say, again, the graphic art skill, I think it's a wonderful thing that you're doing, you know, offering the support to the members, mm-hmm. for allowing them to have an avenue and a space where they can talk about more on a personal side, how to improve and be successful in their personal growth and development. So kudos to you and what you do for the members. I think it's a huge benefit. So focusing now on survival, there are five key elements that I want to share with you all this evening. So, and I also want to share how I have incorporated a lot of those elements throughout the way in my professional job and responsibilities, because, you know, obviously it's when we talk about it, we also have to apply it and see how that works.
Right.
So the first thing is practicing self-advocacy. So you have to be an advocate for yourself. Mm-hmm. If you're not an advocate for yourself, it's very hard to implement any of these things. So the first thing, the overarching idea and the element is to practice self-advocacy. And you're doing that through self-awareness and self-management techniques. Mm-hmm. So what are some of those things that we do? One of the things that I'm learning to do, and I know sometimes it's hard for us, is to say no. And when you say no, it's not about saying no and feeling guilty and feeling bad and horrible about it, but it's knowing your boundaries, knowing that if you're saying no, it's because you're actually saying yes to other things in your life. You're opening up for other things. And that's something that we really need to think about. So when you're saying no, you're letting that person know that you can only do so much with maybe in that certain amount of time, given what you have, what you're doing. And it's not that you can't do that later on, but you're just not going to say yes to every and anything because you want to please everybody. And I've been guilty of that. We've all been guilty of that. But we know that that takes a toll on us. Mm-hmm. And whenever we don't have a limit and don't have a boundary, you know, they say how we let people treat us is how we let them to continue to treat us. You know, when we don't react or we don't say anything, they think it's okay because we're not creating those boundaries for ourselves. So you have to be very careful with that. Mm-hmm. So learning to say no is giving you a leeway to say yes to yourself and other things. So it could be taking time out for lunch. I mean, I've been guilty of not taking lunch breaks. Yep. You know, everybody needs to take a little break, you know, and I'll just keep going. But, you know, at the end of the day, you're burnt, you're tired, and that's not something that is productive for you. Right. So learning to take those mini breaks, not even just your lunch break, but little 5-10 minute breaks throughout the day, because mentally you need to release and de-stress. Mm-hmm. So taking those breaks and, you know, we all, depending on what you're doing, like even in my professional role, we do have a set time when we leave. But leaving by that set time every now and then, and creating some type of schedule where you're going to maybe stay an hour later or so, but creating that time to say, okay, I'm going to leave at this time today so I can do other things in my life, and not just making work be the only priority all day, every day, 24 hours. Right. It's not, you know, it makes us think we're productive. Go ahead.
No, I was agreeing with you. That's a big one, because people just get caught up at work, and then they just think they're being productive because they're there, but they don't realize how much less work they're getting done in the time that they're sitting there forcing themselves to do this thing.
Yes, and I'm guilty of that. It took me a long time to understand that and learn that, but it's so crucial to take care of yourself and to understand your limits. So thank you. Yeah, that's really important. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I do is I create a schedule for myself, and one of the things I try to stick to it. So we talk about things we're going to do, but in essence, we got to stick to the things that we're going to incorporate in our life. So, you know, this at time I'm going to be doing this and that. I'm going to check my emails. I'm going to answer my phone calls. I'm going to work on this project. But then, you know, by 11:30, 12 o'clock, I'm going to take like a half hour break or something like that. And you stick to it. And, you know, we have programs out there where it'll give you a little timer, it'll set off, so that you just follow that. Once you hear it, you know you need to stop. So really just being consistent with those things and following through is important. Yes, consistency. You had just mentioned before, it all intertwines. So self-advocacy is also, which I know we've all heard before, exercise, eating right, getting enough sleep. Sounds cliche, but it's really, really important. When you are exercising, you're releasing those endorphins, your stress level goes down, you have more energy, you're more excited and passionate about being able to do the things you need to do. It's important to get healthy and fit. No one's saying you have to go to the gym and work 10 hours at the gym every single day, all day, but having some type of physical activity where you're moving your body and getting your heart pumping and, you know, everything going through your veins and your body going is really important. Some of our positions and what we do in our lives, we're, you know, sedentary and we're sitting, or we're driving in long hours in traffic, you know, commuting, and we're not taking the time to think about how we can create movement in our lives where we're getting the blood flowing, because that can cause health problems down the line. So in order to be productive, you have to be your healthiest, right? Health is wealth, as they say. Mm-hmm. Eating right, not telling anybody how they should eat, but if you're getting enough nutrients in your body, you know, and that's really important. Your basic nutrients need to be in your body so that way you can function, that you have good brain function and all of that, you know, drinking enough water. Well, that we have to do because our body's mostly made up of water. So we need water in our body to keep us hydrated. You do not want to be dehydrated. I've had that experience in the past. It is the worst thing ever to be dehydrated. You don't ever want to go through that. So make sure you hydrate yourself accordingly and take care of yourself. And getting enough sleep. You know, there's studies back and forth that's controversial about how much hours of sleep, but you know yourself, you know your body, making sure you get enough shut eye so that way you can feel refreshed and relaxed, whether it's like 6 to 8 hours. Some people say they only function on 4 hours. But like I said, you know yourself and you know what makes you feel good when you wake up in the morning. You know your brain and how relaxed you are. That's, you got to stick to that routine.
I know someone that used to force himself to only take naps. He was only taking naps, like 20 minute nap here, 20 minute nap there, 20 minute here. And he would go and go and go. But then I was just like, I would always just wait for the day when he'd be like, oh, I'm out today. I fell asleep. Wow. Like he would just, it's funny because he, no matter how much he would try to just power nap, like every couple of days or so, like he would just disappear for a day and his body is just like, I need that sleep. And it just takes it. So it's like people, to me, I used to think it was crazy because I'm like, just give yourself like a regular amount of sleep so you don't have to like have those full days where it's like, you're just MIA. Like that can't be healthy for you either. Like,
I know, it's so interesting. Yeah. I mean, there's studies out there about power naps, and they claim that people who take power naps throughout the day, I don't know how they do that, but they're able to just be pumped and refreshed. I don't know how I would be able to do that, but they say people try to do that, take little power naps here and there. Like I said, everybody's different. You know, there's no one way of how to do something. You got to know your body and how it works, you know, best for you. Mm-hmm. So also what we're doing now, seeking advice, support, having a support system in place for you that's advocating for yourself. Mm-hmm. You want to make sure that you have somewhere that you could release, someone you could talk to, or a support group where you could, you know, put your heads together and talk about your challenges and how to overcome them, just like you do here with the graphic art skills. So it's like, yeah, it's a great thing that you're doing for the members. Very crucial. So as I explained, these are things that tried or true, things that I've used in my career, both as a creative professional and also as a full-time school administrator. And, you know, you got to try these things to see if they work. You know, it's one thing to say, how do we deal with this? We're exhausted, we're tired. But you have to stick to these routines. You have to try them and see what really works for you. Mm-hmm. But these are really key elements that really can support you throughout the way. So like I said, the first one was to practice self-advocacy, which is self-management and self-awareness. So the second one, which we're going to go more into, is developing a support system, which I kind of ended with previously. Finding a mentor or coach, even personally, you know, and I've done that before. You know, coaches need coaches too. You know, top level people in any organization need their support system. So it's really important, you know, and they say the most successful people have more than one coach, because not, you know, you can be able to know every single area there is, but you may have one for business, one for personal life, one for relationships, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, nowadays that's becoming more of the norm and more acceptable to have coaches, because those coaches, excuse me, can really help you see things differently and push you and hold you more accountable for things that you may have just kind of not really thought about or fall to the wayside. So that's the intuition of having a coach is really great. It's a great thing to do. They say that you are the average sum of the five people that you're mostly around.
Yeah.
So you want to like be sure, you want to be sure that, you know, you're around people that are they uplifting you? And are they enhancing your life, or are they draining you mm-hmm. and depleting from you? Because when we talk about survival and we talk about your mental state, you want to be able to have a support system that's going to help you thrive and get through the challenging times, not make it worse.
GuildCast is a weekly podcast series based on the three pillars of the Graphic Artists Guild: advocacy, community, and business resources. Keep listening to learn more about the Graphic Artists Guild and visit our website at www.graphicartistsguild.org.
I have a question that just came to my head.
Sure.
With something you said. What I know that, like, just in any industry, but I'm sure there are creatives that probably, you know, work for an agency or have a client that they're not so excited to work with. How would you in this situation suggest, you know, using maybe one of the survival techniques you mentioned so far, maybe one you haven't mentioned, to kind of survive those kinds of situations? Because it's not like you can just say, okay, well, I quit per se, because you might need that income. So how would you in this situation suggest that creatives or entrepreneurs survive dealing with a difficult job or
client?
Right.
That's a really good question. So I think the first thing is to think about how you are interacting with this client and how much you need to interact with the client to do what you need to do. So that way you're not feeling overwhelmed or it's making you feel like it's impossible to do the job. Mm-hmm. So just think about creating those boundaries for yourself in terms of how much you have to interact with that client to get the job done.
Right.
And maybe from the beginning with that client, having an understanding of what your expectations are so that it doesn't unfold into something more than what you expected and then you get frustrated and upset. So just setting that guideline from day one for that particular client.
Mm-hmm.
So that way, you know, you could just focus on what needs to be done,
yeah,
and your goal on how to complete it, and then you can move on.
Get her done.
That's right. Because we know it's not easy. Even my job, even as administrator, you know, I deal with, you know, challenging parents, challenging family members, right, and all kind of things. So yeah, we have to figure out ways of how to deal with that.
Mm-hmm. Know when to say no.
Oh, yes, that too. So you should also have someone that can also just listen to you, not someone who's ready to always tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. A lot of times people just want to be heard, and that's part of the releasing that's important for survival. We're always feeling like we're being criticized, and that makes us self-judge ourselves often, or be even harder on ourselves. So you want to make sure that you have a support system of people that will just listen to you. And that's something I've gotten much better at, and especially being a coach and, you know, practicing, is just letting people vent and talk. Mm-hmm. And not really encouraging to tell them what to do, but have them just be able to share out. And sometimes they figure it out for themselves.
Yes.
So it's just giving someone that space to do that. So make sure that you find a group of people that are able to just listen and hear you out, and don't have to always, well, you should do this and you should do that, because people don't want to hear that.
All the time.
They don't necessarily want to hear that. I mean, they may want advice and they ask for it, but they don't ask for it.
Yeah, like,
it doesn't mean that they need it. You know?
Definitely.
So it's just something to be mindful of.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing is making connections and networking. So another way of developing a support system is getting yourself out there and meeting new people, which can lead to new experiences for you. So that's really important. It can open up doors for you and other opportunities in your career and your life. So not being a hermit and, you know, staying in your shell or staying in your office space, but getting out there, going to other professional organizations, other events, social events. There's a lot of things that I know is out there, and I'm sure the Graphic Artist Guild does for its members to get them out there and meet new people. So like I said, it's a really great organization, I can see. And you offer a lot of different things for a lot of events for people.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's really important. Networking, connecting, meeting new people, and getting out there.
Definitely.
So again, the first one was practice self-advocacy, identify self-awareness and self-management. The second element is to develop a support system.
Mm-hmm.
The third one I'm going to get into is organizing and using your time wisely. So again, as much as we talk about the things we need to do or should do or could have done, the importance is to get it done and to just go into gear. But you have to set some type of pace, some type of consistency or pace for yourself, because life gets in the way and you have to practice some type of discipline. And in order to do that, you have to be intentional with your time and what you do day to day. I'm guilty of this as well. Just taking on things and just letting it go through. Before you know it, you're here all hours of the night working on a project.
Yep.
You have to decide when to stop, and you have to decide when to take your breaks. You have to decide when you're going to make time for your family, you know? So one thing I want to mention is that all these things that I'm talking about is also how to develop a healthy balance between work and family life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, no matter how that family dynamics look, husband, wife, children, extended family members, how do you make time? It's really important to your overall personal development and growth, is being whole and being okay. And, you know, it's not just about work, but also how you enjoy life. Right? Having the passion for what you do. It's cyclical. You know, you have a passion, desire, drive. It keeps you going and you produce. And that's where your creativity comes out. But your mental state has to be in its right place.
Mm-hmm.
So the elements that you have to practice for that to happen.
Okay. I have a question based on what you're saying now too. And I had the question beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say, for example, we are in a situation, let's say something happens at work and somebody annoys you, for example,
mm-hmm.
and you still have to work. And if you're a creative, a lot of the times your work depends on your mood. So if you're not in a good mood, you might not produce the best quality work you can.
Mm-hmm.
So do you have like a specific tool that you could suggest or would suggest for being able to switch your mood from negative to positive? in a fairly short amount of time, so you can, you know, get back to whatever it is that you were doing, for example.
That's a good one, because I definitely have gone through those situations. Well, first, if I'm dealing with a colleague or someone that is not in the most positive spirit most of the time, or tries to do things to kind of get you going, I would limit my time around that person. Again, it's part of creating that boundary, you know, those boundaries for yourself. Again, only engaging when you need to, and then, you know, move away from the situation. I find from my experience, when I move away from certain situations, it kind of fades away, because then I can focus on what I really want to do or intentionally need to do. So that's definitely a big one. Another way mentally is to, it's something you have to practice. It's not going to happen overnight. Mm-hmm. But part of practicing for yourself are positive affirmations of, you know, I'm going to have a good day today. You know, some people might say, oh, you know, does that really work? But if you keep doing it, it'll start to be ingrained in your mind. Mm-hmm. I start my day off a certain way generally. And sometimes with my professional job, I have a long commute. So I listen to a lot of positive, uplifting, inspirational videos, speakers, and that gets me going. So when I'm on that, you know, just on the path, I remember what I listened to earlier to this morning, and that kind of stays in my mind. So that's part of getting your discipline in with the positivity awareness that, you know, you can get through the day and things will be okay. Just brush it off as something small. Mm-hmm. Don't let it knock you off. Yeah. But again, that's something that takes time. That's not going to happen overnight. Mm-hmm. But if you practice positivity in your life.
I think a lot of people, though, they think that, like you just said, like, they look at positive affirmations like, okay, you're just, it's floofy kind of.
Yeah, but
where it's like, you're just, you know? So I think it's difficult to get, for example, somebody who thinks that way to change their way of thinking and to continue to think the different way until it actually works. You know what I'm saying? Like, because for me, like you're saying, like you had to practice it. Like, I relate to that immediately, because at first I was just like, oh, this isn't working. Because it's not working immediately. And for some reason, I was just like, you know what? Just keep doing it. And now it's like,
you're chipping away at how you are as a person, how you relate to things, how you react. Mm-hmm. It's really not easy to do initially. But I'm using myself as an example. I can emotionally react to things in the past. And I'm not saying I'm perfect at it, but I've learned to just kind of brush it off and let it go. And it's really helped me become more stronger, you know, emotionally. It's helped me to, you know, just strengthen those muscles that we have, those mental muscles. So that way we're able to cope and deal with things. So, and then I'm able to share my experience and the things that I've done with other people, because I know it works.
Yeah.
You know, 'cause I've tried, it's tried and true, you know. Definitely. And as we know, your time, which this took a while to understand, time is money. Mm-hmm. And money is time. Mm-hmm. And you don't get that back. So we need to be strategic and think about how we use our time. What are those time wasters? And when I say time wasters, are things that we do that are not really, you know, positive to our growth, that are helping us along the way, that are depleting us, taking away, being caught up in things that are negative, that are not productive. You know, I read a lot of stuff. Go ahead.
Getting lost on the internet, on Instagram, scrolling.
It's funny you said that. I was just going to mention, TV is okay, but I really don't care for it.
Yeah.
Because it's just a lot of stuff on there, a lot of noise. That's what I supposed to call it. A lot of noise. Mm-hmm. And it takes away from your focus, and especially the things that you want to do day to day sometimes, or the goals that you have in your life. And so I like to write. I like to read. I love self-help books. professional development. Just love those. I like other books too, but I really navigate towards those, you know, mm-hmm. passion.
Yeah.
And and listening to like TED Talks and things mm-hmm. like that. Internet can be good if you use it in a way that promotes growth. Healthy growth and, you know, but if you're using it that way, if you're not and you're just looking at like, you know, sites that just gossip about stuff and, you know, and then some of this stuff is made up and or embellished too. So we're like falling over all these things. Sometimes it's not even accurate. So, you know, so to each his own. But if you want to be on the path of focus and you have these goals in place and you want to be successful, you really have to discipline yourself and take the time to use your time wisely and say, you know, what am I going to do with this amount of time? Am I going to read? Am I going to listen to this? Am I going to go to conferences? I'm going to meet new people. You know, if you're sitting in front of the TV all day, hours pass, you're on the internet scrolling, surfing, hours pass, that's time you're never going to get back. You know, those are hours, days, months, whatever, that are gone.
Yeah.
Also, it's just something to think about. So again, creating some type of schedule for your life, for work, even your family life, you know, the way things are, you know, family schedule they schedule things within their family. Okay, we're going to do family time at this time. Mm-hmm. It's not a bad thing, but it puts us to be held accountable that we're going to make sure we spend time with our spouse or significant other, that we're going to make sure we spend time with our children, right. You know, that we make time for our families. You got to schedule that in. At least you're being intentional with your time. So it's not a bad thing to do that. It's better to do that and be in awareness of it than to just let everything fall to the wayside and you're not even focusing on your family because you're just so busy working. So be intentional how you're using your time.
Coming up on this episode of GuildCast.
And how do we do that? There's a state of mindfulness that we need to practice for ourselves. So being in tune with your giving and your receiving in general. What are we giving out there from ourselves to others, and how are we receiving it back, right? And being thankful for life's blessings.
Join the Graphic Artists Guild to listen to the full version of this episode at www.graphicartistsguild.org. Thanks for listening to GuildCast. Coming up in next week's episode,
kind of like leading into the tracking expenses, you should be tracking your expenses mm-hmm. every month. You should have a profit and loss statement. So learn how to do one of those. It's not as hard and scary as it might sound. You can get a really easy template on Google Forms for how to do this. Balance sheets are a little bit trickier. Also very nice to have, but not absolutely necessary at the start. But a profit and loss statement you should have. And having a separate bank account will make it exponentially easier to track your expenses every month. Knowing what money is coming in and what money is going out is very important to determining whether or not you have a business, whether or not it can support itself.
GuildCast is a weekly podcast series based on the three pillars of the Graphic Artists Guild: advocacy, community, and business resources. Keep listening to learn more about the Graphic Artists Guild and visit our website at www.graphicartistsguild.org.